Welcome to our final Toronto FC Touchline Talks of 2021. Wheels up, Gareth Wheeler with you. We finally made it, and we couldn't wrap up this campaign without looking ahead with the new man in charge of Toronto FC. He's the new head coach and sporting director of TFC. He is Mr. Bob Bradley, joining us for the first time on the Come On You Reds podcast. What's up, Bob? How are you? Welcome.
Thanks, Gareth. Good to be here.
It's something I feel like it's been made in the stars. It's many years coming. I've seen you on various road trips supporting Michael along the way, and now you're actually part of the team. It just seems fitting that you finally landed here in Toronto, Bob.
It feels great for both my wife and myself. From the time that Michael arrived, we appreciate so much what Toronto's all about, what TFC is all about. It's an incredible sports city, and we've been able to just see the connection between TFC and the fans. We were both here on that special night in 2017. I think it was December 11th. And so, we have a really good idea of what it's all about. And one of the things that I feel is so important in coaching is that you have a team, a club that connects with a city, and that there's a real identity that everybody can see, and there's a real passion for what that club's all about. And I know that's been the case in Toronto, and we want to make sure now that we can be part of that. So we're really excited.
We wanted to take some time today to kind of get into what that vision may look like, tap into who Bob Bradley is, the person, the man, the coach. So it's very cool to have you here today. You've been a builder over the course of your career. You've cultivated winning conditions basically everywhere you've gone, Bob. What makes TFC now the right move to take that next step in your career and kind of write that new chapter? Because you have a wealth of experience, both at the collegiate, the pro game, domestically, overseas, as well as the international game as well. So how does TFC kind of fit into that Bob Bradley picture?
Yeah, as I just said, the starting point is the connection that already exists between the club and the city. And, for me, I've always enjoyed the opportunity to go into a club, get my arms around things, start to make sure that as a team, we have an identity, we have a way of playing. One of the other things that I really consider to be a priority is also that we have a connection between the way the first team plays, the second team, ideas that go on right into the academy, so that as we move along, there's a real good chance that we can develop young players that can move through the pipeline and move into the first team.
You've had challenges over the course of your career in various places that you've gone. I remember seeing you even on a day. I was in Ellis Park, actually, seeing USA Slovenia when you were in touch on the sideline there. Like, you've experienced so much over the course of your career. So if you're kind of trying to diagnose what the biggest challenge might be here on this next step, what is the biggest challenge? I'm sure it changes by the day, Bob, but what are you looking at as the one thing that needs to be established first and foremost?
I've been very careful so far. I don't want to ever talk about reboot, rebuild, this kind of thing. When you go into a situation, for me, whether a team has gone through a period of success, whether there's been a year or two that haven't met the standards, the starting point is just getting a feel for what's going on, getting your arms around things. The best example probably in football in the last period is Klopp going to Liverpool. That, look, the success of Liverpool over all the years speaks for itself. Yet a guy like Jurgen Klopp goes in, and in his own way, without disrespecting anything that's ever happened, starts to show his personality, starts to have an idea of what Liverpool can be under his guidance. There's a clear picture then that when we step on the field, we represent all those teams in the past. We represent all these fans. We represent the city, and it's got to shine through every time we step on the field. It would be stupid of me today to start giving specifics as to exactly what that means, because until you start working with players and starting to challenge them and find the balance in all this, you don't know exactly what it looks like. But I think still a team that has good ways to go forward, a team that creates chances, a team that works hard. So when we lose the ball, there's a real attempt to defend as a unit. You want the tempo of the game to be high so that everyone who comes in the stadium feels that excitement from the beginning to the end. So there's these kind of things that I think you see in top teams. And then we just have to figure out now in this group how to put those pieces together.
It's a funny game, isn't it? Like, things change so quickly, yet they don't change at all in a lot of ways. We saw the MLS Cup raised this past weekend with New York City FC coming away with it. Even from the time I feel like you started with LAFC as an expansion team, like, the league continues to evolve and change. Do you feel like you've had to evolve and change with it? Or do you kind of stay tried, tested, and true to what your philosophy is all about?
Yeah, I was out of the league for a long time. I had really good experiences in the early years. Obviously, I was part of DC United in 96 and 97. And then the five incredible years in Chicago. When we talk about going into a sports city and having a team that people loved to watch and felt part of, I think that's still an important part of what took place in Chicago. The other thing that happened there is we had an incredible mix of veteran players that came to Chicago, not only motivated to win, but motivated to be really good examples for young players that we found and brought through. And an awful lot of those guys are involved in the game in MLS today as coaches and as general managers and sport directors. So, I was part of it. And then, yes, I was the national team coach, and then I was outside the country. And so when I came back, my thoughts were simple. I talked to ownership in 2017 in the summer at LAFC, and I sort of laid out my ideas. Here's the kind of team we want to have. Here's what the culture should be like. You have an incredible city. We need to have a team that has diversity, a team that when people in the city look at that team, they feel like it's theirs. When we look into the stands, we see Los Angeles. And I think we played some incredible football. For a first-year team in 2018, we were pretty darn good. 2019, in terms of just the quality of our football, the number of goals we scored, incredible goal differential. I mean, every game we were pushing like crazy, and I think people could see that. There was disappointment to lose in the playoffs to Seattle. And then 2020 and 2021, so many different twists and turns, but still we made sure that the football ideas never changed. And then there's just a sense that, look, after 4 years, sometimes everybody needs to step back and figure out what comes next. And for me, the opportunity to take my experiences, my ideas, my passion for the game, and come here to Toronto, where I've seen firsthand through Michael's experiences what goes on. That was something that, needless to say, it meant an incredible amount to me, and hit the ground running. There's a lot to do.
It's funny, Bob, like, all of a sudden, across the league, LAFC became everyone else's second favorite team across the league because of that rock and roll style, because of that attack-minded football that you played. It was breathtaking at times. And quite frankly, you and that team have helped take this league forward just in terms of style of play. Is it as simple as trying to replicate that template here in Toronto? Or do you take some of that, add things to maybe a different way of looking at things, you know, kind of build it around what's already been established and then take it forward that way? It's because that's a great question probably among fans right now, Bob, is like, are we going to see that LAFC type style of football be played here in Toronto?
When I think about football, I always think about great teams. So sometimes even when I'm working with a group, I'll say, look, on one side, you can look at the best Barcelona teams, 2009, 2010, 2011. And what I always saw in those teams was incredible fluidity. All of Pep's teams have control, their ability to control a game. He has changed slightly over the years because in his attempts to control games, he understood how important it was to understand transition and being able to make sure that you don't give up big chances in transition. But on one side, you have that. You have control. You have positional play. You have a lot of passes. And then on the other side, you can pick. You know, if I mention Liverpool again, it's a little bit more vertical. It's a little bit more where the tempo is high all the time. Klopp would talk about heavy metal football. And I think that with every group you work with, you have to try to determine between those kind of examples, where's the bar going to be for us? Certainly if you look at the best of TSC, second half of 2016, 2017, 2018, the ability to move the ball from back to front, the ability to control the tempo of the game. I think those things were incredibly special. I think in football, you have to continue to move along. And so how that part of a team then gets pushed to add intensity. You know, there was a very interesting comment after Bayern beat Barcelona last week 3-0. Thomas Müller said, I don't think Barcelona likes our intensity. And so Bayern has been able to take a mix of things. They're good with the ball. They're incredibly athletic. They're dynamic. They still go after teams. They press. They play with a high line. So I think we just have to try to establish with players as we get going different football ideas and test them and push them in training every day and find the way that works, that's going to work best for this group.
You walk into a club where you mentioned it, there's winners in this team, right? There's winners in this squad, and there's going to be a foundation here of players that you'll move forward with. At the same time, it's being acknowledged that there's clearly going to be some more change over the course of this offseason. In order to build out of your squad, what type of player are you looking at, Bob? You know, other than really good players, but what type of player do you want to see to be able to execute your vision here and take this program forward?
Yeah, in a general way, I talk about players that love the game, players that love to compete. They show up every day. They're excited for training. They want to be coached. They're open to new ideas. It stays fresh. It stays current. You had a player at TFC recently, Laurent Simon, and obviously maybe at the beginning he wasn't a big Toronto favorite because he started in Montreal. So I know how that works. But I had Laurent at LAFC before he came to Toronto. And one of the things that I appreciated is that as an experienced player, he really still wanted to be coached every day. He wanted to get better. He wanted to be pushed. And I think that's key. I still remember when Lee Wynn came to LAFC and I joked with him and said, you know, look, Lee, if you left New England and you went to Barcelona, I don't think that you would just show up there and say, look, this is how I've played my whole career and that's going to work. I think you would have figured out quickly that you needed to be open. And I said, LAFC is not Barcelona, but I need you to be open. I need you to be excited that now there are things that maybe are going to be different. In the past, you had this idea that when your team had the ball, you just could go anywhere on the field to get the ball. And at LAFC, you have to trust some of your teammates. We don't need you following the ball and just going anywhere. We need you in certain moments to realize that if I stay in this spot, the ball's going to come to me and I'm going to be dangerous from here. So those are just quick examples, Gareth, that you've got to have players, young and old, that want to be coached. It sounds easy, but when things go a little bit off the tracks, then what happens is too many players show up every day and they think they've got all the answers. They think they're better than they are. And so just an ability to have guys that are excited. They love the game. They want to compete. And man, every day they are excited about being coached.
I think there's a lot of excitement too, seeing some of the young players come through into the first team at this club over the course of this past season. What do you make of what you've seen? I know you haven't been around for that long, but are you encouraged by what you see in the young players and the way that MLS goes or has been going, I should say, Bob? It seems like younger players are getting more and more of an opportunity. I know you just don't want to give them opportunity. They need to earn it. But what have you seen out of this young group? And can we expect, you know, more opportunity for young players moving forward with Toronto FC?
I can't answer that today. Look, I'm a believer in young players. So, you know, if you go all the way back to Chicago, we had guys like DeMarcus Beasley and Carlos Bocanegra and Josh Wolf, all play important roles as young players. And I could go through every team I've coached. You know, my shining example at the moment is still being lucky enough to work with a 19-year-old Mohamed Salah and bring him into the national team in Egypt. And then see what he's done. He's obviously an amazing player, and he's even a better guy. And so I say that with the idea that when I get to know the young players here, I think I can say two things. First, I can say, look, I'm not afraid to play young players. But secondly, I think I can say, but I know what good is because I coached Mohamed Salah when he was 19. So you've got to show it. You've got to prove it. You've got to show that you're ready to step on the field and make a difference. And when that happens, we'll all be ready to put you out there and help you.
What have you learned over these first few weeks at Toronto FC? Has anything jumped out to you that you might have not expected, might have not known about the club?
There's been no surprises. The thing that I love the most is still coming into the training ground every day because the group of people who are here represent the best of the best, just really good people. Love the club, proud of what they do every day. And you know, I'm a training ground person. You know, I love coming in. I love joking with everyone, getting to know people. And I have just absolutely enjoyed what it's like here every day. They start to get to know me a little bit. I also love the fact that I see academy players around here every day. And when we talk about the talent in the academy, I see the young players and I see diversity. I see players, different sizes, shape, different colors. That reminds me very much of my time in France because, as everyone knows, that the talent pool in France is so diverse, the multiculturalism in France is such a huge part of their football. And I think that's also true in the Toronto area. Look, I've also in the last couple of weeks been able to start getting out and seeing some of the young academy teams. I get to see some of the youth football because I've had the chance to watch my grandson Luca play a little bit. And when you go into any of these indoor facilities right now, it's the same. You see all these different teams, you see kids, different sizes and shapes, but you see talent, you see young talent. And that's exciting for me.
Bob, you've mentioned a number of your stops over the course of your career, whether it was in the Premier League or in a World Cup, you have such an impressive resume. Was there one stop along the way that you feel like you just kind of came into your own as a head coach where you just kind of felt comfortable and were able to take your project forward? What did you have that moment or is it just being kind of gradual gains over the course of your career?
It's gradual gains, but I would still say a couple things. You know, my first professional coaching job was in Chicago. It was an expansion team. I mentioned a little bit earlier, but you know, our first signing was Peter Novak. It meant an incredible amount to the Polish American community in Chicago that our first signing was the captain of the Polish national team. And we had a team in Chicago that, again, every one of us that was part of that period, whenever we see each other, there's this sense of what we were all about. We all remember training sessions that got really competitive. We remember stories from inside the locker room or at halftime, things where you had a competitive group and what the football was about. So for me, that was important because as a young coach, when you coach guys like Peter Novak or Lubos Kubik or Christos Deutschkoff, you learn quickly that to gain their respect, you can't be in awe of those guys. You've got to hold them to high standards like you would anyone else. And when you do that, then you see that part is what they respect. And so I loved the opportunity as a young coach to work with big players, to learn from their experiences and then to test myself. And I think I've been able to sort of continue along with those ideas every place I've been.
We just have a couple minutes left. It's interesting because you named some really big names right there, Bob, and kind of MLS has shifted a little bit in the way that it's worked, where a lot of younger players are coming into the league in order to develop them in terms of talent. Like, you're not seeing the same volume of those established superstar players, if you will, coming into Major League Soccer. Do you still think there's room for the superstar player to come into this league and make a tangible difference as the league continues to evolve?
I do. I think every club has to figure out for itself what it wants to be. We did set out at LAFC at the beginning after we signed Carlos to look for young talent. To some degree, that was successful. I think at LAFC in the last period, we also had discussions that maybe the bar had moved a little bit too much towards some of the young players and that we had lost some balance. If you go back to, obviously, 2017 with TFC, you had the core of DPs and things were built around those players. So I think there's different ways to build teams. I think the part that is loud and clear is that MLSE and then, of course, the fans and the city, they want winners. And so there's no doubt that when you come to Toronto, the starting point is a team that's going to go on the field and represent the city and try to win trophies. That's what it's all about.
A lot of excitement. The new schedule for the new campaign will be released, I believe, later on this week. The holiday season is almost upon us here, Bob. What does the roadmap look like for you and this group over the next coming weeks and few months building up to the new season?
There's a lot to do. Obviously, there's things with the roster. There'll be discussions about free agents. I'm still putting together staff, laying out plans so that when we start preseason, the ways that we work, the ideas are all laid out ahead of time so that there's a real clear idea of how we can get going. So there's a lot of different things that keep me busy every day, but it's all very exciting.
Fingers crossed. I mean, I know what a challenge COVID, really was for all the Canadian clubs last year. Are you encouraged by kind of the state of play where we're at right now, that some of these issues that, were real issues last year might be a little bit easier to kind of navigate through this time around?
Cautiously optimistic. Yeah. Let's face it. I always pay attention to what's going on in all areas. I know that in Canada, in terms of restrictions and vaccination rates, there's a lot of things that have been done well. Now the opportunity for kids to be vaccinated. So there's a lot that's happening. And so I'm always cautiously optimistic that will allow football and, more importantly, everyone to get back to a little bit closer to normalcy.
Awesome. Fingers crossed. All the best to you. We're thrilled to have another Bradley here in the city of Toronto. Look, you might have lost a Will Ferrell, but you added, a Gareth Wheeler. I mean, that is a poor man's version, but we'll try to do our best to entertain you, make you feel at home as we move forward here at Toronto FC. Thrilled that you took some time here today, Bob. It's awesome.
Good. Thanks, Gareth. All the best.
Bob Bradley, your new head coach of Toronto FC and sporting director, joining us here on the final Touchline Talks of the season. Thank you for your support, your viewership, your listenership over the course of the year. And we're going to be back at it in 2022 better than ever. On behalf of our producer, Erica, Terry Dunfield, he's lurking somewhere. I'm Gareth Wheeler. Wheels down on the 2021 season.